year 2001, I'd say most Americans didn't know a whole lot about Islam. But then when the 9/11 attacks happened on our country, we learned a lot about Islam. Not all truthful, perhaps, but we learned a lot more than we had known before. And what we learned certainly did not seem very good. It didn't reflect well upon that religion. But likewise, people who don't know the truth about Jesus Christ look at you and me. And if our behavior is selfish, uncaring, unloving, people get the impression that our God is selfish, uncaring, and unloving. And on the other hand, if we are very joyful in serving people, in listening, in being patient with others, then people get a sense of what our God is all about. Jesus said in our gospel lesson today, "Let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." In fact, as Christians, we represent our God every day. We represent Him even more than just our actions and how our offhanded comments might sound. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, "We are Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making His appeal through us." In other words, Jesus was here teaching people on this earth, but then after His resurrection, He ascended up into heaven, but He still is speaking today through you and through me. Jesus is represented by each and every one of us as we talk to others about His love. In today's first lesson from Isaiah 49, Jesus is speaking about His mission on this earth, which was not just to save a few people, not just to get Israel out of its slavery. He came here to this earth to be the light who spreads His life the ends of the earth. And Jesus has called you and me and all of us Christians to be united to Him, to follow after Him, and that means we now take up this mission too. As it says in the gospel, "You are the light of the world." Today we're especially going to focus upon how we get to do that through our church and through our Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod. As Jesus, the true light of the world, reflects His light through us. In our account here, we read from Isaiah 49. It starts out with Jesus saying this: "Listen to me, you idols. Hear this, you distant nations." And just from those words, let's stop for a second. Jesus didn't come here again just to speak to the Jewish people. He came here to have His word be proclaimed to the ends of the earth. If you read the book of Isaiah, long book, again and again, you hear reference to this. God's word going out to the nations. God's word going out to the islands. In other words, the most remote place that could possibly be. Because Jesus came here to be the Savior of this whole world. We can thank God for that. We who don't live in Israel. We who, many of us at least, don't claim that we are descendants of Abraham. And Jesus came to be our Savior too. He came here to take our sins away so that we could be a part of God's church. Today we're going to think about how that message is continuing to be spread to the ends of the earth, even to places where we might not think it could easily get. "Before I was born, the Lord called me," Jesus says. "From my mother's womb, He has spoken my name." It's a real comfort to know that God's plan of salvation was carefully laid out, even before God made this world. He knew exactly how He was going to take care of us, and exactly how He was going to save us. It's not like God had to come up with plan B when sin came into this world. It was all laid out by Him. He knew what was coming. And that's important to us to remember as we realize we are God's representatives today. God has a plan for you, and He knows exactly what it is. He had it laid out even before He made this world. He knew how He was going to use you to influence other people, the love you would show in your family, the friendship Sermon on the Mount, where he talks about you are the light of the world. You're not supposed to be hidden, like trying to hide a candle under a mask or something like that. You are to be shining out to this world. Jesus knows exactly how to get to us. His law gets to us. His law convicts us of our sins, makes us uncomfortable, makes us get down on our knees and tell God we're sorry. And his gospel, his amazing good news, tells us that no matter what we have done, it is forgiven. Jesus really did live and die to pay for every sin that we have committed, and God loves us for now and for eternity. That is Jesus' message, like a sharp sword that accomplishes exactly what God wants it to do. And it does it no matter what language it may be proclaimed in. When we send people out to share this message, we are confident that Jesus is speaking, no matter what language it might be, that they are proclaiming his true message. Jesus says, "It's in the shadow of his hand he hid me. He made me into a polished arrow and concealed me in his quiver." Of course, when Jesus was here on this earth, he didn't look all that impressive. And yet, he says, "The Lord said to me, 'You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will display my splendor.'" Jesus is called the servant of God, not that Jesus was lower than God, but because Jesus came here in order to fulfill God's purpose, in order to serve God by serving us with the forgiveness of each and every one of us. And in this way, Jesus brought glory. The Lord God displayed his splendor in this common-looking man who went from town to town, showing love to the people that everybody else wanted to reject and ignore, helping out those who were in need, using his power to actually heal those who were there day after day, and doing that again and again so that God's splendor, God's love would be filling hearts all over the world. Today, God still does that as his word, his sacraments are brought to people at the ends of the earth and to create saving faith. Jesus is God's servant. All he had to do is a servant. But I said, I have labored to no purpose. I have spent my strength in vain and for nothing. Yet what is due me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with my God. Think about Jesus, loving all people perfectly, helping out where no one else would, and he gets rejected. Jesus performing these amazing miracles, and the people turn against him because he's not getting enough, because he's not doing exactly what they wanted. And yet he kept on. He kept proclaiming the truth of God's love. He kept demonstrating it day and day after day until he finally took it to the cross and giving up his life because he knew that God the Father was with him. And he knew that his reward, ultimately, was with God. His vindication, his resurrection. And he's taking up his crown, taking up his throne where he rules over all things for our good. And ultimately, his reward of providing salvation to like us, so that we could join and live with him eternally in heaven. What a wonderful God we have. seek of and bring back those of Israel I have kept, I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. Jesus had an amazingly difficult task. And even when he did his wondrous acts, so many people turned away from him. And yet he said, I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength. Trusting in the Father, Jesus, who had become a real man, could keep on going to the cross and beyond, because he knew that the Lord was with him. And when we, too, face challenging times, we can keep on going, trusting that God will be with us